us want clean water, all of us want clean air, all of us want to protect our environment. But we really have some people who very, very left environmental activists running EPA. And so it's a big issue. It really is. And I can get, you know, I can talk about this district, for example, and the state, like I mentioned, the coal industry. Right now, the EPA is trying to, and mine safety is trying to change the dust regulation for underground coal mines. It's been in place for more than 30, 40 years. My dad was a United Mine worker, by the way, underground coal mine for 37 years, so, you know, I understand that environment. But they didn't release this. There's no scientific data that showed, that said, well, why are they changing that today compared to 5 years ago or 10 years ago if there was a problem? Because the incidence of what's called black lung has dropped precipitously since the 70s when they did put, when they really did need to change things. I mean, it's dropped dramatically down to a level that, you know, I mean, you're not ever going to make them. If you've ever been down in an underground coal mine, it's not like being up here. And, but they put in a regulation that they're trying to. I think that they did get it through last Monday. That will make it almost impossible for a lot of coal companies to comply and make it very difficult. And what will that do? That's going to, especially for the 8th district, because every coal mine in Indiana is in the Wabash Valley in southwestern Indiana. Every coal mine. And that's going to have a huge economic impact on where we live today, and on our state as far as energy prices. So that's one thing. They're reinterpreting the Clean Water Act, and which is a big issue because the water quality that they want downstream from factories and other businesses is cleaner than, like Dasani bottled water. I mean, it's so clean that, I mean, that it's almost impossible to do it. In fact, that's another one where they don't really have. I asked the question at a hearing with one of the EPA people. Well, where did you get the data? You know, did you take samples from streams all around the country and see what just the normal level of some of these things is, just to see what your baseline is? And they didn't have an answer for that. But it's that's just an example. That, by the way, is going to really be a big problem for our agricultural industry in Indiana, because they're trying to expand definition of what part of what water that they control, what EPA controls. Right now it says navigable water, which makes sense, rivers and things where you can navigate. They want to change it to all water, which means if you have a stream going through your backyard and someone from EPA comes to your house and tests the water, and if it doesn't meet these strict requirements, they take over your property. I mean, because you're not in compliance with the Clean Water Act, and that's, they're trying to expand their, you know, for the agricultural industry, imagine what that would do if everywhere out there, you know, every little fence row would have through if the federal EPA now can basically shut you down unless you comply with that and comply with regulations of those types. So that's a long question, an answer to a short question, but everybody in D.C., and it's not a partisan issue actually, is concerned about the current of people who are putting out rules in EPA. Yes, sir.
I've been involved with several people discussing the EPA recently, and there are a lot of concerns.
Yes.
And no doubt when the EPA was first formed, there's probably a legitimate reason for that.
There was.
But now it seems that they have great power and authority. And where does this power and authority come from? Does it come from the Congress? Does it come from the President? And how can some of this be taken back?
It comes from them. I mean, agencies in the U.S. federal government have broad power, almost unfettered. Now the Congress can, if they can overturn a rule that's put out, but you have to have, you know, say the EPA puts out a rule that says you have to do this. The Congress can overturn that, but it has to pass the House, the Senate, and the President has to sign it. So you can't, just like any other law, you have to have that kind of consensus to overturn it. They've got broad power. It's very concerning. I didn't really recognize how much power these agencies had until I got in Congress. But, so a lot of it depends on, political appointees, whichever party it is. The EPA, we've had issues with the EPA, in all fairness, not just recently, but for decades. They've got broad power. We can overturn it. We've tried. We've voted in the House a couple times to try to stop them on a couple things, but it doesn't get taken up at all in the Senate because their views are, the administration agrees with their view, and so does Senator Reid. So it's concerning. The other thing is we had a hearing the other day about what the federal EPA is doing. Just states have their own environmental. States, they have their state EPA, so to speak, and we heard testimony the other day from people from all over the country, from state EPA, bipartisan, both Democrats and Republicans, and the hearing was about their concerns about what the federal EPA is doing, in their state, without regard to their state agency and what they're doing, and what we heard was that they're rolling over the states right now. The federal government, EPA, is rolling over the state EPAs. And they're very concerned about it. And we heard this again from people from both sides of the aisle. Very concerned about it. So it's a problem. And I'm doing it personally. I'm on the Transportation and Infrastructure Committee, which has some role in overlooking EPA, and we're in a bipartisan way trying to get a hold of it, but it's hard because they just like we had Ms. Stoner from the EPA there, and she's a lower level EPA person, but the end justifies the means for them. I mean, literally, apologies to any environmentalists in the room, but if it was up to the people that are in control now, humans wouldn't live on the earth. I mean, almost. I mean, they want to really almost make it, zero impact of all of us living here. And that's just not possible. So you have to be reasonable about it.
One other thing I'm concerned about, too, about this dust. I farm,
yep.
And when the soil gets dry enough, you're going to have dust. And in the fall, whenever you combine soybeans, you've got dust.
Yep.
And then another thing, the county, we're letting a lot of our county roads go back to gravel. You've got dust. And we can't let the EPA tell us what to do. I'm concerned about what they say about dust, too.
They're trying that surface dust, like country roads, like you said, either at the time when you're harvesting or when you have gravel roads. It's a big problem because they have an idea about the level of dust, and they're trying to regulate that and control that. And it's another one of those things which is impossible to do.
It would run the agriculture,
yes,
industry in this country.
It would hurt them.
Yeah.
So it's not only the Clean Water, but it's the Clean Air Act that it will have a significant impact on agriculture. That's true. And again, the agencies have quite a bit of power. And the way I think, and that's another one of the reasons why I'm here today, the way we as citizens can impact this is in the court of public opinion. if we can't reverse these rules, and they know that we can't, we can get these things changed in the court of public opinion, and it will force political people that disagree, to change their views. For example, EPA on their boiler admissions have backed away from that regulation about, and which would have resulted in billions of dollars.